Did history predispose us not to know the horror of the reality of a hunger strike? Yes. Did we know about the death of Terence McSweeney and other people? Yes, we did. Did we ever read in history about the day-to-day experience of what that meant for Terence McSweeney and for Terence McSweeney's wife? Did anybody ever ask them? If they did it as now get filtered out of history in the telescoping of the heroism, which is not denied? I think it's a mistake to consider the hunger strike as ever having been some kind of tactic. The hunger strike at all times was a last-ditch despairing movement on the part of the prisoners to die with dignity as opposed to die with none.
There was no question of negotiation at all. There was no question of concessions during a strike. If this is the way they wanted to go, then it was on their heads, be it.
They were a terrorist organisation. Their activities were illegal. Their activities were repugnant to a majority of people down here.
Prison protest on the outset in this country was mobilising tens of thousands of people in support. It was creating a huge crisis for the Irish government, and it was politically poisoning the atmosphere.
I was against the strike because I thought that people were going to die.
It is perfectly clear that there are enough votes in this constituency to elect Bobby Sands.
When he was elected, we were elated. He was now an elected MP, and we all believe there's no way could the Thatcher government allow him to die. Right? Well, we were naive.
Well, one's interest at that time would not have been what was going on in republicanism, but what was going on in the nationalist community as a whole. And we would have seen the way in which the nationalist community as a whole was so easily manipulated by the republican movement as deeply depressing.
When you get people charged by emotion, first thing that goes is intelligence. Everyone blaming the government and not stopping to consider that the person in the coffin had actually put other people in coffins.
It was an utter tragedy, and the intransigence of the IRA and their lack of concern for the prisoners and willingness to let the thing continue and people die, and the British stupidity in dealing directly with them. That's where the full tragedy of the hunger strike came from, those two.
After more than a decade of the Troubles in the North, at the beginning of the 1980s, Ireland was plunged into political turmoil as Republicans in the Mays prison near Belfast went on hunger strike. What followed was not only an intense battle of wits between the British government and the IRA, but a bitter fight to the end. This is the story of how 10 Republicans inside the Mays prison starved themselves to death. The story of how their campaign to be seen as prisoners of war and gain political status divided the people of Ireland. It was a dark and defining episode in the bloody history of the Troubles. One that had many unforeseen consequences and continues to change the political landscape, but which began in the mid-1970s. Then, the British government had decided that Republican prisoners, in many cases men convicted for bombings and murders in the North, should be treated no differently to common criminals.
I think it's important to recall and to realise in the midst of a peace process here that this was a period when there was a war on. The British, being foolish about these matters, thought that somehow if they could imprison Republicans in cells, take away the, if you like, POW status image of Long Cash, that probably would add to their argument. Look, these people are all criminals.
It would seem to us perfectly reasonable for the government to assert control over the prison and put an end to the compound POW type situation.
They introduced special interrogation centres where prisoners were tortured, confessions extracted. They introduced the H-blocks. They built them purposely to house political prisoners, but to deny them political status. They then removed political status, or the special category status, in March 1st, 1976.
Well, political status was absolutely essential because the Republicans had never accepted that their campaign or their whole dynamic was anything other than political. And bear in mind that the British attempt to criminalise the Republican insurrection, the Republican community, wasn't merely confined to Republican prisoners. It was an attempt to criminalise the entire Republican process, the entire Republican project. It happened that they could do it most effectively, or thought they could do it most effectively, to flee to the prisoners.
Any civilized country, you have a set of laws and your judicial procedures, and if people break the law, they're taken before these courts and they're convicted and sentenced. As far as most people in Northern Ireland and Britain were concerned, anyone involved with explosives, with guns, with killing people, with maiming people, as far as they were concerned, they were criminals who were in prison.
I was in Crumlin Road Jail in September 1976, and we were constantly discussing about the implications of the change to phase out or remove political status. And so there was some talk, but nobody really knew how we were going to handle this. And I think it was Ciarán Nugent was sentenced. That was the beginning of what we now know as the blanket protest, because Ciarán Nugent refused to wear a prison uniform. So Ciarán started it, and then of course others followed, and slowly but surely then the struggle for political status begins to take shape inside the prison.
The protest started in September 76, the ordinary, you know, refusal to go along with the criminalisation, refusal to wear the prison clothes. And I don't think the prison authorities ever envisaged that it would have grown until the length that it did. But by March 1978, by that stage, there was, I'm sure there was about 150 people on the protest, and numbers were continuing to increase.
By this stage, the prisoners' campaign for political status had developed into five demands, including the right to wear their own clothes instead of a prison uniform.
I can't remember how many was on the blanket at the time, but I remember going down, people were into the first year and went into the second year on the blanket when I went there, and we thought this was unbelievable. We met these here boys with their big beards and whatnot and the long hair and everything else, and all, we were coming in, this were like rookies, and we were saying, my God, these people have been here for a year. But little did we know that we were going to be there for another 5 years.
As the protest continued, but with no sign of concessions from the British government, the blanket men resorted to a new and desperate tactic, one that became known as the Dirty Protest.
Republicans knew they were not getting anywhere by just refusing to wear clothes, because they weren't winning anything, they weren't achieving anything. So the next thing they decided they would, whenever the staff went down to slop them out, says, no, we're not slopping out. So the only thing they could do with their shit was put it on the wall.
We used to crap and put it in the corner, but the stench of it was really unsustainable. Some somebody came up with the idea that if you spread it on the wall, apart from it dries, which means that it doesn't have the same impact upon you, apart from the initial couple of minutes that it takes to do that. But it was absolutely unbelievably horrendous.
I think most unionists find the position somewhat outlandish. Saw the dirty protest as being absolutely a form of bestial behaviour, and took the view that the persons who would voluntarily behave in that way were making themselves somehow less than human. And I think the unionist community would have had just intense contempt for people who behaved that way.
The actual blanket protest was a very onerous protest for the men involved and the families of the men involved. We knew that in physical circumstances, because many of us were doing very long sentences, that it was unreasonable to ask our men to stay and remain in these conditions indefinitely. We knew we were coming to a situation where we had to take very radical decisions, and it, being Republicans with our history, with our tradition, with what was at stake, bear in mind, because what was at stake was the key question, the crucial question, is this struggle, is it a criminal conspiracy, is it an aggravated crime wave as the British had attempted to deem it, or is this a political struggle with political objectives being carried out by politically motivated people? That was what was at stake.
On the streets, the Republican movement mobilised its supporters, but also tried to win sympathy for the prisoners' demands within the more moderate nationalist community.
Well, the SDLP had been in favour of some form of political status. And throughout this whole period, the SDLP supported anyone who had any proposal which we thought might have contributed to a compromise, whether in relation to the British government or Sinn Féin. That, of course, receded when Maggie Thatcher took over as Prime Minister in 79, because she made it very clear from the very beginning that under no circumstances would she accept political status.
We saw Thatcher as being a very repressive leader. She herself created the expression that the lady's not for turning. She was seen to be a real, real problem in terms of being a pragmatist, or in terms of being flexible, or in terms of abandoning this issue.
Well, as soon as she had become leader of the Conservative Party and leader of the opposition, Irish politicians, particularly Gareth Fitzgerald, maintained a good contact with her. But the nature of the relationship in those early years was almost that of a teacher and a pupil. She knew little about Ireland. She had very little feeling for what was happening in Ireland. And that extended, in my view, to her not fully appreciating or understanding unionism, no more than she understood republicanism or Irish nationalism.
Outside the prison, the IRA intensified its armed campaign. In just one day, the 27th of August 1979, it killed the Queen's cousin, Lord Mountbatten, in Sligo, as well as 18 British soldiers in an ambush in South Down. Amidst such carnage, and with the election of Margaret Thatcher as Prime Minister just 2 months earlier, the IRA prisoners saw any hope of concessions from the British government recede, and they began to plan their next dramatic move.
The period leading up to the first hunger strike was one of immense discussion and debate within the prison. And I happened to be on the same block as Brendan Hughes, same wing actually as Brendan Hughes and Bobby Sands. And Tommy McCartney was actually in the next cell to me. So what occurred was a series of discussions with all prisoners as to what road should be taken. And there was a general consensus that hunger strike should be adopted. This only came after a very, very protracted head-to-head between the prison leadership and the leadership outside who were opposed to hunger strike action. And it was a very, very hard battle.
Well, it was made very, very clear to the prisoners that we on the outside were opposed to hunger strike. We were of the view that Thatcher wouldn't bend.
They would advise that they didn't feel it would work. They didn't felt it was too dangerous. You know, we were going out and you were putting all your eggs in one basket.
We were saying to them, look, you can't stop us going on a hunger strike because you cannot do anything to end this nightmare that we are living in. Right? Now, if you can't end it, we're going to have to end it ourselves.
They were reluctant to easily or blithely give us the go-ahead to go on strike. So they told us that they were going to have to think very seriously about it, but they had to think about it in the context that they had been unable to break the deadlock. Eventually, they were brought around to accept the fact that they could not break the deadlock, and they said that we then could, if we wished to and thought it best, to go ahead with the strike. There are very specific rules and regulations within the IRA that a hunger strike cannot be embarked upon by members of the IRA without the very clear, specific sanction of the Army Council, who can call, allow it to go ahead, and equally can call it off.
On the 27th of October 1980, Tommy McKerney and six other Republican prisoners refused their prison food. They insisted that if the British government did not meet their demand for political status, they would starve themselves to death.
Mrs. Thatcher's line on the hunger strike was emphatic from the start. In other words, there is no political justification for murder. You can have a blanket protest, you can have a dirty protest, you can go on the hunger strike if you want to kill yourselves, that's up to you. But there is nothing that's going to move me on the question that murder is murder, as she once put it. In that sense, what you have from the government at the start is a fairly inflexible and formidable stance. We are not going to yield on this.
She saw the demands for political status as simply an attempt to weaken the authority of the state, and secondly, so far as hunger striking is concerned, it was terrorism by another name and another route. And she wasn't going to give in to that.
It created a difficulty for the Irish government because, on the one hand, no Irish government could demand of a British government that it concede to the prisoners, because, after all, in the southern jurisdiction, there was never any question of the government conceding to the demands of prisoners. On the other hand, all Irish governments realised that unless the situation was handled with tact and with great care, what would happen would be that support for the IRA would inevitably increase.
Coming weeks, you must bend every muscle, strain every nerve in support of the hunger strikers. This is a showdown with imperialism.
Throughout Ireland, the Republican movement did its utmost to rally support for the hunger strikers. But inside the maze, as one man reached a critical condition and rumours of government concessions began to circulate, the prisoners decided that this strike should not end in death.
It started on the 27th of October and it finished on the 18th, 19th of December. And what transpired was it was a series of private sort of interventions. People had made representation to the Northern Ireland office. We had asked the Irish government, we had asked various agencies to intercede to try and bring a bit of pressure to bear on the British to negotiate or to either grant the five demands or at least send somebody in to negotiate.
halfway through that hunger strike, the British government had reactivated a back channel. There was talk that they were prepared to introduce a progressive liberal regime which would deal with all of the concerns of the prisoners. And we on the outside asked for proof of that.
What happened was at the changeover of documents, and there's this whole scenario whereby the priest who was visiting the prisoners and on hunger strike and then dealing with Bobby Sands as the OC was given documents at an airport, and when he arrived at the prison hospital, Sean McKenna had been in a critical condition and was to be shifted to Musgrave Park Hospital, and I think he was lapsing into a coma.
It was like this surreal game of poker where the cards were the lives of people in that prison, and everybody was holding them. The government, the Irish government was holding them, British government was holding them, the prisoners were holding them themselves. And right in the middle, Sean McKenna's dying. It's a question of who folded first.
What transpired was there was almost a position that was acceptable, that there was documents produced that, depending on the manner in which you read it and depending on what way it was delivered by the British, that there was a way out of the dilemma for everybody concerned. It was decided on the strength of what was contained, that rather than allow him to die for something that was en route, just needing agreed, that the hunger strike was terminated.
Convinced that a deal was on its way from London, the hunger strikers believed they had not only saved the life of Sean McKenna, but also dealt a serious body blow to Margaret Thatcher and the British government.
There was a whole air of, relief that no one had died on it, concern about Sean when you had been taken to outside hospital, hoped that he was okay, and I suppose a whole sense of expectation.
The hunger strike was called off at, if I remember, 4:30 on, I think it might have been a Thursday, December the 18th, and it was broadcast on downtown radio. And Sean McKenna's life was saved. And therefore, of course, our own lives were saved. And then the negotiations really got underway as to how this could be implemented.
I was in with Bobby Sands, the OC of the protesting political prisoners, and he was extremely buoyant this morning and very, very happy about the outcome.
But the prisoners' euphoria was not to last. When a priest, Father Brendan Maher, delivered the British government's document, one that they believed would satisfy their demand for political status, they discovered that it was vague and open to interpretation.
The British government thought that this was an opportunity to put more pressure on the prisoners, that this was an opportunity to grind the prisoners down, and then they started to deny that they were involved in a deal with Republicans.
No, I don't think there were any decisions taken while the hunger strike was on, but certainly there was a concession after it was on that people could wear civilian-type clothing, but provided they obeyed the prison rules.
When that strike ended, there was much recrimination about what had been promised, what hadn't been promised. What the NIO, the Northern Ireland Office, had offered was something which did meet some of the demands of the prisoners, but by no means all of them. There was some movement on clothing, but not to the freedom of wearing your own clothes that Republicans wanted. There were aspects of the deal that didn't suit Republicans. And once the strike had ended, it's clear that the authorities felt that there was perhaps less imminence in implementing the sort of things that the Republicans wanted because the strike had been beaten. Republicans claimed that they had been promised the five demands had been met and the British had now reneged. It's unclear whether that's the case. So it was a murky period. But because Republicans were unsatisfied with the way that things ended and the treatment they received afterwards, they didn't win their five demands after the first strike, they fairly quickly decided that a second strike was going to begin and that this one would be, in a sense, an even more resolute conflict.
Convinced that they had been tricked by the British government, the prisoners began their second hunger strike just 3 months after ending the first one. This strike was to be led by IRA man Bobby Sands. And this time, it was to be a hunger strike to the death.
Four prisoners have taken their own lives deliberately. I do not know of any religious leader or politician who is urging me to give political status. Not one. Every single one of them knows that to do so will be tantamount to giving some people a license to murder innocent men, women, and children.
Spring of 1981. Republicans in the Mays prison had been on protest for 5 years. But still, the British government refused to meet their demand to be treated not as criminals, but as political prisoners. Now, to increase pressure on Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, the prisoners prepared to go on hunger strike for a second time.
There was a recognition prior to the first hunger strike that hunger strike was the only action that was going to bring this to conclusion. And it was felt that a second hunger strike should be embarked upon. And when this was broached with the leadership, I'd say they almost had apoplexy.
We were against the strike. I personally was against the strike. I was against the strike because I thought that people were going to die. And also, to be quite sort of tactical about it, because we couldn't afford another huge prison crisis, which then ended the same way as the first one.
The IRA leadership were, generally speaking, against the hunger strike. But Thatcher had set her face against a deal with the prisoners. And so the prisoners knew then. The die was cast, I suppose. And they set about organizing the second hunger strike.
Everybody was unhappy that we were going into it again. But I mean, that was Ireland, wasn't it? That was the problem in Northern Ireland. It was a problem of terrorism. You got the impression that they would try any tactic, and they came again.
This time, the hunger strike was to be led by Bobby Sands. And he was determined that the mistakes of the past would not be repeated.
In the first hunger strike, all seven prisoners had gone on hunger strike together. Bobby Sands then decided a different strategy for the second hunger strike. First of all, they wanted, he was going to go out on hunger strike on his own 2 weeks in front of everyone else. So is that whenever he was at a critical period, the next hunger striker wouldn't have been as critical or as vulnerable. And the second thing that he demanded is guarantors of a settlement. Now, myself and Gerry Adams were named as external spokespersons. And we were regularly cited during that period as those who Bobby wanted, and then subsequently the other hunger strikers wanted to be present to ensure that the deceit that was involved in the first hunger strike could not be repeated.
While preparations for the protest gathered momentum, to many people outside the prison, the IRA hunger strikers deserved neither support nor sympathy.
We would have seen the tactic as being fundamentally immoral. We would not have understood why people were supporting such a tactic and why even clergymen seemed to be tolerant of it. and or to find excuses for it. And again, this would have reinforced many unions the view that the nationalist community was essentially deeply sectarian.
The hunger strike also created a moral dilemma for the hierarchy of the Catholic Church. While some clergymen admitted support for the prisoners' demands, others warned of the consequences of their actions.
Bobby Sands sent for me and we had a long good dialogue. And I put this up to him. I said, this strike's going to cause grave grief, firstly to your own family. It's going to cause a loss of life outside the prison, because our passions will rise very, very high. In fact, over 60 people were killed, murdered, during the second hunger strike. And I said, it'll cause a grave civil discord. But he could only see he had a prison vision. And you often get that with prisoners. Their whole thing is in the prison. That is the world. And he said to me, greater love than this no man has than a man lays down his life for his friends. So I said, Bobby, I'm not going to bother you anymore. You're obviously in good conscience. He was in good conscience. He knew what he wanted to do, and he was going to do it.
A Republican prisoner at the Mays prison in Northern Ireland refused breakfast this morning and says he will fast to the death to achieve his aim of political status. Bobby Sands, who's 27, is serving a 14-year jail sentence for firearms offences.
I'd never heard of Bobby Sands until just in the weeks leading up to him going on hunger strike in 1981. I think there was an immediate recognition that for the leader of the prisoners, the commanding officer of the prisoners, to say, well, I'll be the first to step forward the second time around. I think there was an immediate understanding among a wide range of people that this was for real.
It was sort of accepted that the first four men would die. I mean, that was the position that was accepted. Bobby accepted that. Frank and Ray and Patsy O'Hara, they accepted that there would be no movement. We never thought that there would be a movement until at least they died. We were prepared to go the whole way with this. Come what may, X amount of men would have to die, then so be it. And that was the strategy. It was like a main game with the Brits. We needed to convince them that it was long term. That's the way it was.
Remember one Sunday morning at Mass talking to Bobby Sands. I remember him saying to me, have you got your head around this? I says, yes, I have, and I know where we are and I know what we have. Right, who's replacing me? And I says, what? He says, well, who have you got to replace me? And I was sort of a wee bit phased out about it, because here's a guy saying to me, well, I'm not going to be here in 6 weeks or 8 weeks or whatever it is, and who have you got to replace me? And I felt a wee bit awkward about it. So I said to him, look, you need your head around this. He says, I'm going to die, and you need to have it clear in your head who you've got to replace me. And he says, well, if you must know, I says, it's Joe McDonald. And he says, that's a good choice. Joe McDonald never let you down. And away he walked, looking for somebody for a wee bit of tobacco. Left me standing, but I think it was Jake. And I just turned and said, I don't believe this.
For the second time in 4 months, the Republican movement attempted to win public support for its hunger strikers. But at first, it did so in vain.
There was always likely to be some public support for it. We saw it on the streets outside the British Embassy. But the support was significantly different from, for example, the support following Bloody Sunday in 1972. In 1972, support for the Republican movement briefly became very widespread. By 1981, I think the situation had changed, mainly because their campaign of violence in that period, 80-81, was particularly vicious. I mean, they had created a campaign which did not have popular support in the Republic and which inhibited people who might otherwise have shown some support for the hunger strikes from giving any support.
The Republican movement launched a familiar campaign to harness support for the hunger strike. But just 4 days after Bobby Sands began refusing food, the political landscape changed dramatically. On the 5th of March, Frank Maguire, the independent nationalist MP for the bitterly divided constituency of Fermanagh and South Tyrone, died unexpectedly. Initially, Bernadette McCallisky, who was still recovering from an assassination attempt by loyalist gunmen, planned to stand for election, opposing the nationalist candidate backed by the Catholic Church. But before long, she initiated a plan, one that would be an unprecedented step for the Republican movement, to increase pressure on the British government.
It was proposed that I would certainly not stand idly by while the Catholic Church picked candidates for Fermanagh, South Tyrone. That's where we started. So we now had this unseemly situation where we had two candidates in an election and a prisoner dying. So we were running a dual campaign on the ground saying, I'm not standing back for the bishop. I'd stand back for the prisoner, but I'm not standing back for the bishop. And creating the momentum where people were then going to Sinn Féin saying, will you let the prisoner stand? So they started negotiations to see if they would stand their prisoner.
It wasn't regarded initially anyway as, you know, some great sort of idea, because there are massive reservations about it. Republicans hadn't been standing in elections. What have we stood in? There wasn't support.
At the time, Republicans absolutely hated elections, wanted nothing to do with elections, and it was even in the IRA constitution you weren't even allowed to talk about standing elections. So it was different.
They were grasping for publicity. Strike's no good unless it has publicity, and this would give them lots of publicity.
The attractions were, it was a method of galvanizing mass support, demonstrating to the world the prisoners had support, and were Bobby to win, he would have a mandate. British government's always been challenging us, where's your mandate? We can't talk to you, you don't have a mandate. If you had a mandate, we could talk to you. So it would create an opportunity for resolving the hunger strike without anyone dying. Danger, of course, was that if Bobby Sands lost by 5 votes, 1 vote, Thatcher would crow, even your own people rejected you. So, I mean, these arguments were put to Bobby. Bobby understood the dangers involved, and, he had the prescience to say, yes, I will go forward.
There was a suggestion that Bernadette McCallisky, Bernadette Devlin, was going to stand. I think she may have actually nominated, or was going to nominate, and also Noel Maguire.
Jim Gibney come to ask me, would I stand down for a prisoner? And I said, there wouldn't be any doubt about it, Jim. There'd be absolutely no, I think that's a brilliant idea. And then I said, but you'd need to go and talk to Noel Maguire.
As an independent nationalist candidate and the brother of the MP who had just died, Noel Maguire had strong hopes of winning the by-election.
Noel Maguire took longer to get out than we had imagined. We hadn't actually counted on Noel having a wee bit of ambition. Then we got word Noel was pulling out.
Well, I withdrew primarily because I have been told that at this moment, it's a question of conscience on my part. Bobby Sands, I am informed, his life depends on my withdrawal and his election, and I would not have the life of anybody on my hands.
Do you feel you've been pressured into making this decision?
No, it's on this question, it's a question of conscience. My own conscience.
So Mr. Maguire's decision to stand down means that Robert Sands, an IRA man who couldn't take his seat even if he won, and wouldn't anyway want to belong to a parliament whose authority over Northern Ireland he doesn't recognise, has turned out to be the only candidate from the nationalist, or to put it more crudely, the Catholic side in the race.
Well, it clearly was a very emotional time. And it put a lot of moderate nationalists in a difficult position. They didn't approve of what the provosts were doing. And on the other hand, they didn't approve of what Thatcher was doing.
I think we knew that it created a huge problem for the Catholic Republican tradition.
And when Hardy came to Hardy, the hunger strikers were Irish and Thatcher was English.
I think we waited with bated breath, believing that somehow a majority of that tradition would resist the temptation to demonstrate sympathy. This wasn't the 1920s. This was, in fact, the 1980s.
In asking people to vote for Bobby Sands, sort of the propaganda line at the time, and it was a very apt one, was simply support the five demands, support, I said, put them in to get them out, save the man's life, loan us your vote. You know, that every platform here says, loan us your vote. We're not asking for your vote for republicanism, for the armed struggle, for, you know, sort of, we're just asking you to put this man in because it could save his life. I mean, what an appeal. And that made it relatively easy to mobilize the entire nationalist community in Fermanagh, South Tyrone.
It is perfectly clear that there are enough votes in this constituency to elect Bobby Sands.
In essence, Bobby Sands and those of us who support him are only borrowing the election. Now, if we elect Bobby, which we can do, and I don't want after tonight anybody that's working in this campaign ever again saying, if we elect Bobby. It's when we elect Bobby Sands.
There was a necessity, actually, to try and, like, not to temper the enthusiasm, but to temper the expectation if it was a successful result.
Would this allow us to break the situation? Will this allow us to save Bobby's life? Now, we knew the political consequences, but it's very, very difficult to be dispassionate when you're talking about a friend's life, and that's what it was.
We were racing against the clock, you know, because we had some experience of how quickly a person deteriorates on hunger strike.
At the time, what you have to remember is that we were in a very desperate situation. I'm almost sure during the campaign you had four prisoners on hunger strike. So, you know, their lives, the clock was ticking on their lives. Genuinely, we said to people, if you elect Bobby Sands, you'll save his life. Because we believed that at the time.
And that, of course, appealed to the people outside, naturally. Vote for Bobby and save his life. And they pushed on the election like that, and that's how he got elected. I voted for myself.
The news that we were getting in was that Bobby was having a realistic chance of success. We were told by the wing OC that we would be getting the news as it came through from the count because we had radio smuggled in.
There's only one way we were going to find out the result of the election. If somebody turned on a radio, and there was no other way that we would have known. So I told everybody, see, because there was a radio on each of the wings we were on, and I said to them, see if this result comes in positive, not to be getting into this massive jubilation, just to quietly pass the word around.
On the day of the count in Enniskillen Technical College, where it was, that was just an absolute incredible time.
I, the undersigned, being the acting returning officer, hereby give notice that the total number of votes given for each candidate at the election was as follows. Sands, Bobby, anti-H block, Armagh, political prisoner, 30,492. West, Henry W., Ulster Unionist, 29,046. And I declare that Bobby Sands has been duly elected to serve as a member for the third constituency.
The election of Sands had a fairly negative effect on politics, in the sense that we saw the nationalist community overwhelmingly voting for, clearly, the IRA. And whatever excuses people give about lending votes and all the rest of it, it clearly had a polarizing effect politically.
I think that was, for me, the greatest betrayal. The fact that no matter what, they voted for Bobby Sands and elected him. That really was the most difficult moment of all for unionists, to think that their Catholic neighbours would, in our minds, glorify the people who were killing us.
It's very difficult to analyse why people voted then, or indeed now, for Republican candidates. They may have asked people to lend them their votes, but of course, once they got the votes, they were very careful to hold on to them.
Inside the Mays prison, the hunger strike was about to enter its sixth week. But now it was being led not just by Bobby Sands, IRA man, but by Bobby Sands, Member of Parliament. It was a huge propaganda coup for the Republican prisoners, and one that dramatically intensified the pressure on Margaret Thatcher and the British government.
When Bobby Sands was elected, there was elation amongst the prisoners in the jail, the Republican prisoners, and there was euphoria amongst the movement as a whole, because they'd taken a gamble with this election and he'd won it, and it was attracting huge international opinion. And it seemed finally to nail the view that these were criminals, because they could say, how could we be treated as criminals if we've got this many votes for this man?
In some ways, when Bobby Sands was elected, we had won political status. The population had spoken. Tyrone and Fermanagh had said, he is our MP. We don't care what Margaret Thatcher says.
There was a feeling at the time of Sands' election, which was apparently serious, on the part of a number of very senior Republicans, that if he was elected an MP, then Thatcher simply couldn't let him die. That the idea of an MP dying on hunger strike was so outlandish that even Thatcher's government would recoil from it.
But to many people, there was nothing to suggest that Margaret Thatcher was about to give in to the demands of any IRA prisoner, even if he was a Member of Parliament, and even if he was starving himself to death.
In view of what Maggie Thatcher had been saying, we felt there was no chance of Thatcher giving in to what she considered to be blackmail. The election of Bobby Sands, while it was obviously a great fillip for the Republican movement, they were on a heading to nothing as far as Thatcher was concerned.
Any human being, particularly anybody with a knowledge of Irish history, was bound to be moved by hunger strike deaths. It's a long, and one might say a noble, tradition in Irish history. Hunger strikes do arouse feelings, and there was no knowing how far those feelings would run, how high they would run, and there was no knowing how difficult it would be for an Irish government to deal with it. So it was a period of considerable tension.
In March 1981, Ireland was thrown into political chaos as Republicans in the Mays prison near Belfast went on hunger strike. Led by Bobby Sands, their aim was to gain recognition as political prisoners.
The hunger strikes weren't simply a matter of an internal prison dispute. They were to do with the winning or losing of struggle.
I personally was against the strike. I mean, I was against the strike because I thought that people were going to die.
The 10 prisoners who died on hunger strike became icons for the Republican movement. But for their political opponents, they were simply men of violence who had killed or attempted to kill British soldiers, policemen and civilians.
These guys, or their fellow runners, went out, deliberately targeted my brother and two colleagues, and they shot them in the back, as is the modus operandi for the Provisional IRA.
The dynamics were there to almost guarantee disaster.
The hunger strike caused chaos on the streets of Belfast and Dublin, and ultimately was to create tensions between prisoners and within the Republican movement itself.
Our problem was, the problem in any hunger strike, was when is enough enough?
These issues be debated. What has to be gained now? But nothing more will be gained from one other death.
This was totally and completely manipulated by godfathers. People who wouldn't have put their own sons on hunger strike, let me say.
They seek to work on the most basic of human emotions, pity, as a means of creating tension and stoking the fires of bitterness and hatred.
Personally, I felt then and I feel now that hell is not hot enough, nor eternity long enough for those who stood and watched men die.
From the BBC Radio Newsroom, this is Brian Perkins with the 8 o'clock news on Saturday, the 2nd of May. Church leaders and politicians in Northern Ireland have appealed to people to remain calm and not be influenced by predictions of impending trouble over the hunger strikers.
Get on TV! Get on TV!
During the night, there was sporadic rioting in Belfast and Londonderry. Petrol bombs were also thrown.
By April 1981, the hunger strike was wreaking havoc throughout a bitterly divided Northern Ireland. But when Bobby Sands was elected to the Westminster Parliament, Republicans believed the British government would have to give in to their demands.
Maggie Thatcher and others in her cabinet were saying things like, Republicans don't have support. They're a bunch of criminals. Nobody supports them. And of course, when over 30,000 people voted for Bobby Sands, it instantly demolished the argument that they didn't have support, because 30,000 people don't vote for a criminal.
It totally destroyed and undermined their whole propaganda thrust.
To say that a mandate to go on murdering folk is a complete misreading of the situation. I don't think that the Roman Catholic population generally were in support of seeing their neighbours murdered.
As tension mounted throughout the north, Unionists became increasingly concerned about how the crisis might worsen.
I think we were less worried about whether the government would concede as to whether, in fact, this would cause an escalation and counter-escalation of the violence on the streets.
As trouble intensified on the streets, inside the Mays prison, four hunger strikers edged ever closer to their deaths.
and on the 18th of April, just 9 days after he was elected to the British Parliament, Bobby Sands was given the last rites in the prison hospital.
IRA hunger striker Bobby Sands is said to have lapsed into a coma. His mother says he's dying, and she's appealed to people to stay calm and not get involved in any fighting.
Well, a couple of days prior to May the 5th, the news reports were talking about him lapsing in and out of coma and his breathing being extremely laboured. And on the night of the 4th, I had the radio set wired up to the grills after the screws had gone. And I listened to the 12 o'clock news, and then I was going to go to bed, and then I listened to the 1 o'clock news. And I went to bed and I thought, no, I'm just going to whatever I can here. The first item on the news at 2 o'clock, and I remember distinctly the journalist, David Cammer, saying that at 1:17 a.m. on May the 5th, Bobby Sands, IRA prisoner, MP, hunger striker, died.
The wing was very quiet. I think everybody was, it was a very somber mood. People were talking in their cells as opposed to, you know, from cell to cell.
You cut the atmosphere with a knife. Because once I knew that this had happened, this has gone all the way. Is this going to keep on going all the way?
It was a very emotional period for us because we were in a situation where this guy had literally laid down his life for us, for his fellow IRA volunteers and NLA volunteers. And I mean, in our view, the British had killed him.
For Republicans, Bobby Sands may have been a hero who had made the ultimate sacrifice. But among those who saw him as a terrorist, as a member of an organization that had killed and maimed hundreds of their fellow citizens, his death was viewed differently.
Excuse me, sir, can I ask you how you feel about Bobby Sands' death?
Delighted.
It's your own fault. Nobody wanted me there, he wanted their cell.
Oh, I don't like to see anybody down, but it was his own choice for to do so. Like, after all, he's in there for a criminal offence, and it's up to himself, you know?
I think that many within the Protestant community would not have looked at the bigger picture. I think that many would have had the view, well, they would kill us, so if they're killing themselves, that's all right.
When Bobby Sands died, it was a non-event, so far as we were concerned. It was something that happened. It was something that he had chosen for himself. It didn't impact on us at all. In fact, the only impact that there would have been was one of relief. Sad and all as it was, probably for the wider family. But for us, there was a sense of relief that this guy was now out of the picture and he can't terrorize anybody else.
Republican funerals have always drawn a crowd here in West Belfast, but never a crowd quite like this. Quite simply, this is one of the biggest political funerals in the history of Ireland.
On the 7th of May, an estimated 100,000 people gathered in West Belfast for Bobby Sands' funeral.
The world unjustly focuses its attention upon the burial of an IRA convicted terrorist who took his own life in the Meath prison.
Bobby Sands' funeral was the biggest nationalist demonstration in Northern Ireland history, ever. And it was a demonstration not for Brits out, not for, you know, let's support the armed struggle. It's a demonstration for somebody who had died simply to be recognised as political, about status.
On the day of his burial, you had tens of thousands of people from all over Ireland there in solidarity.
The press interest was phenomenal from around the world, and it was clear to us that, you know, why weren't the British government realising and appreciating the damage that they were doing to their own reputation?
I don't think international criticism carried any weight whatsoever, because she knew that they didn't know what was going on, especially in North America, naive as they come.
The daily list of atrocities reported in full in Irish media simply was not reported in the States. So that when you got to hunger strikes and the funerals of the hunger strikers who died, this became front page news. And in particular, the descriptions, the colour accounts of these funerals absolutely blew Irish America's mind open and blew the wallet open.
As the impact of Bobby Sands' death reverberated around the world, the next three hunger strikers continued their protest in the Mays prison and saw little option but to follow Sands to the grave.
The fact that Bobby Sands died placed in many ways a heavy onus, a burden, on the next man. And when Frank Hughes died, it became inevitable that Patsy O'Hara would die. It became inevitable that Remy McCreesh would die. They did on the same day. These are all young men. Patsy O'Hara was only doing 8 years. He would have been out within four. He had already done three on the blanket. It meant that had he conformed to prison rules and regulations, he would have been out within 6 months. And he died.
With the death of a fourth hunger striker, violence on the streets of Northern Ireland continued to worsen and threatened to spiral out of control.
I actually think the fear element within the police and within the establishment increased. As more hunger strikers died, more people became very impassioned.
Now, can you give me a reasonable explanation why we cannot go the traditional route?
The level of violence intensified, street disorder. And I certainly felt at that stage that we had reached a road that could maybe lead to the civil war.
As the violence intensified, the funerals of the hunger strikers continued to attract the international media and vast crowds of mourners. To some observers, it appeared the crisis was now being orchestrated to further Sinn Féin's long-term aims.
Well, Sinn Féin was waging a pretty brilliant propaganda war. The huge crowds who had attended the Sands funeral and the other funerals had a tremendous effect on public opinion.
One disliked those people, whether they were media people or political spin doctors. One despised them insofar as they gave a degree of credibility to people who should have had no credibility.
The Sinn Féin were doing very well. They had massive worldwide publicity. It was perfect for a political party. It was perfect. Loads of money coming in. Distinguished visitors, journalists from all over Europe arriving in Belfast and coming to their HQ. They were having a great time. They were having a ball while the men were dying in jail.
While the leadership of Sinn Féin was managing the situation outside, the leader inside the prison, Bic McFarlane, was starting to face questions about the purpose of letting another man die.
Our problem was, and it was, I mean, it's always going to be the problem in any hunger strike, was when is enough enough? When do you say that these people aren't for moving?
People say, Bobby Sands is dead, let's call it off, we have made our point. We have shown the world we're political prisoners, we have made that sacrifice. That was a thing going on.
From my perspective, I was disturbed with some of the things that Bic was saying. Saying in as much as he was trying to look beyond Joe McDonald, and I wasn't so sure. I was of the opinion that we go as far as Joe, I bring Joe to the brink. If the pits don't move then, I didn't think they were ever going to move. So I see no point in letting Joe die.
After refusing food for 48 days, on the 24th of June, the fifth IRA hunger striker, Joe McDonald, was taken from his cell and admitted to the prison hospital. But as McDonald lay dying in the maze, in Dublin, the newly elected Taoiseach, Garrett Fitzgerald, backed a fresh initiative, launched by the Irish Commission for Justice and Peace, and aimed at breaking the deadlock between the prisoners and the British government.
The people involved on the Irish Commission for Justice and Peace side were obviously in contact with Dr. Fitzgerald as soon as he became Taoiseach. And they provided the channel for creating a compromise outcome.
I can remember we all felt very apprehensive. You know, we had no idea what we were heading into. I think at that point we hadn't a lot of hope, but we couldn't not go. We felt if there was any slight chance at all, we needed to go.
We wouldn't have been surprised to have been told that there were various people trying to broker things around there. I mean, that's always been the case here in Northern Ireland. There's no shortage of people who are putting themselves forward as if they can somehow resolve these issues.
At the beginning of July, a delegation from the Commission travelled north to meet the Northern Ireland Office Minister, Michael Allison, and to see if the hunger strike could be brought to an end before the death of Joe McDonald.
We found that Michael Allison gave us a lot of time. I mean, he got into great detail, which gave us a lot of encouragement. He got out big maps of the Mays prison, and we all got down on our knees, and we spent several hours talking about the possibilities of different arrangements for association and what doors could be open when and what might happen. And there came a point where the obvious need was for us to meet the prisoners, to get inside the prison, to see the layout of the prison and to meet the prisoners.
After their meetings with Michael Allison, the Commission believed they had established the basis for an agreement and went to the maze to urge the prisoners to accept their proposals and call off the hunger strike.
They came, they visited me, they put a complete case scenario to me about how they could resolve the issue.
These people were coming in and telling us, look, we have talked to these British officials. They have told us that all you have to do is do this, end the hunger strike, and we will ensure that you get A, B, C and D.
They were saying that they had the substance of the five demands and that they were convinced that the British would yield to it.
And we were saying, but, you know, where is the proof? You know, where is the documents that they have given you? Where is this written down? Where the prisoners had to be absolutely certain that if they ended that hunger strike, they could see in black and white in a piece of paper what it was they were ended for.
They needed some proof that this was real, that it wasn't just something that was being said to us.
to keep things moving along.
It was a simple matter of communication. Then the British government could communicate with the prisoners, either through Gerry Adams or someone that the prisoners trusted, or else directly with the prisoners themselves. It wasn't rocket science, it was simple.
The commission left the prison in the early hours of the 4th of July. Later that day, the prisoners released what appeared to be a conciliatory statement, giving fresh hope that the crisis would soon be brought to an end.
As I understood the ICJP proposals, they seemed to offer a way through. And then that was followed by the conciliatory statement by the prisoners, saying they were not looking for special privileges, and the British could solve the problem without any sacrifice of principle. Well, that was a very different approach from that of the IRA. And the fact that prisoners seemed to have escaped from the control of the IRA organisation temporarily and to be taking control of the situation themselves, that did seem encouraging. We thought it looked as if this problem could be solved.
The pressure began to increase, and attention focused on whether the deal brokered by the Commission would be guaranteed by the British government. But away from the media spotlight, the Commission's efforts to find a breakthrough were about to take an unexpected turn.
We got a call to say that Gerry Adams would like to meet us. Information that we got was that a man with a blue car would be down outside the bar at the lower level, and that if some of us could slip out of the hotel and get into the blue car, it would be taken to a safe house where Gerry Adams would meet us. Now, what they told us, I suppose we were again very naive, but what they told us shocked us and shocked the rest of the Commission members when we met them again.
What the Commission was about to discover was that through a top secret channel of communications codenamed Mountain Climber, other negotiations were already taking place. Negotiations between Downing Street and the Republican leadership, and through which the British government had offered a deal.
There had been a contact which the British had activated. It became known as the Mountain Climber, and basically I didn't learn this until afterwards. Basically this came out of a group of people in Derry.
The British had strange ways of doing things. They were publicly talking to a number of groups during the period of the hunger strike. But when big decisions came, or big offers had to be made, or big fish had to be fished, It always went through the Mountain Climber, or Link, all that type of situation. There was a phone call on a particular night direct to Maggie Thatcher as she was on her way to a conference in Portugal. Agreement was, or what she was offering that night, was basically what the hunger strikers ultimately settled for. Now, there are some disputes around that, and I wasn't there, so I can't be authoritative around that, and I can't say which is right. But the story I heard at the time was that she made an offer, and the person who was on the phone, involved in this linkage, said to the person from the Republican movement, "I think you have to take this offer. You should take this offer." And I think the answer was, "No, it has to be the prisoners who have to make up it." And it didn't happen, and it went on, and a good few other people. I think at that stage, if my memory is right, about three people were dead on the hunger strike at that time. About three. And it went on to become, obviously, more.
By this stage, the concern for some people was not only that the hunger strike looked set to continue, but that negotiations had been taking place between the British government and the Republican movement.
It was always assumed that both governments would take the same line in relation to the IRA. Otherwise, how could we possibly succeed? And the assumption was, from the beginning of the Troubles, that the Irish government would have no contact with the IRA and the British government would have no contact with the IRA. So, in fact, it was quite a treacherous move on the part of British governments. On the one hand, they were pressing us to deal rigidly and firmly with the IRA, in particular in relation to security matters. And on the other hand, they were offering them tea and biscuits.
I have no knowledge of it. I have no knowledge of whether the Prime Minister authorised it or not. But I think in these circumstances, I would have been very surprised if there weren't contacts of one kind or another.
I had a particular problem because when I knew what had happened, if I, in talking to Margaret Thatcher, referred to it and said, yes, your people have been in touch with the IRA, and she denied it, which she might feel necessary to do, well, then obviously the whole relationship became changed utterly. So it seemed to me that it was too much of a risk to tell her that I knew what was happening. And to that extent, of course, my attempts to persuade her to change were, well, I had one hand behind my back. That was a very difficult situation, difficult to judge how to handle it.
Among those most disturbed by the emergence of the secret talks were the delegates from the Irish Commission for Justice and Peace. They realised that their own attempts to establish a deal between the prisoners and the British government had been in vain.
I have not said that the British government lied.
But you are implying they went back on their word.
I'm saying that they assert that Mr. Allison acted in good faith and that all day yesterday there was a clawing back on the part of the British government.
Margaret Thatcher made it impossible for me ever totally to believe anything the British government would ever say. There was a ruthlessness in this situation, and it was there on both the side of the IRA and on the side of the British government. And both the IRA and the British government were assessing Joe McDonald's survival. If there was a brinkmanship going on between Margaret Thatcher and the IRA at that point, it was a brinkmanship that went too far.
The commission withdrew from all negotiations. Now the lives of Joe McDonald and his fellow hunger strikers were hanging in the balance, and the only thing that would save them was the Republican leadership making a deal directly with the British government. By June 1981, as the hunger strike entered its 13th week, four Republican prisoners had already starved themselves to death. But through the secret line of communication known as the Mountain Climber, the British government had made an offer to the Republican leadership. The question now was whether a deal could be done.
The main worry that the prisoners had at that time was the British government would offer them the sun, the moon and the stars. But it would be merely an offer, it would never be tied down, and the prisoners wanted that guaranteed. Therefore, it was agreed that I would go into the jail on the Sunday when there was no visits. There was a big reaction against that whenever I entered the prison, very cold atmosphere from the prison officers. One senior officer turned around and said, "This is a fucking sellout. What's that bastard doing in here?" And he was ordered to shut up.
I can remember them as coming in or being told that they were coming in because they were banned. They were barred from coming into the jail.
The way we looked at it was a sign of good faith on the part of the British. The fact that they were allowing Donny in was the beginning of the movement towards a resolution.
Danny Morrison, who was one of the most eminent and articulate of Republicans of this generation, was part of the group outside the jail which was involved in dealing with the issue of the strike. And if Morrison was visiting the jail, that meant something serious was afoot.
I went in and I think there was about 8 people there. Joe McDonald was brought in as well. And Joe had gone blind and was in a wheelchair. And he asked me about the proposals. And we told him what they were offering at that stage. And they said, well, we want it guaranteed.
I think it is clear that there was a serious offer, or at least the basis for a serious offer being made at this time, and that it's one which came about as close as the British were going to yield. I think it gave most of what the Republicans wanted in substance. The question of whether or not by this stage, after there being 4 deaths, Republicans felt they had to hold out for all 5, hold out for victory or nothing, was a difficult one.
They wanted someone, either a British minister or someone senior from the NIO, to come in and to state what was on offer. And if that was stated and if it was guaranteed, then there was real prospect of the hunger strike ending.
In an attempt to clarify the situation, the government agreed to send an official from the Northern Ireland office into the Mays prison. He was due to arrive at 8:30 in the morning of Wednesday, the 8th of July. But just 4 hours earlier, the 5th prisoner, Joe McDonald, died on hunger strike. And as McDonald's life ended, so too did any hopes of a deal.
I remember just hearing Joe was dead, and I was just totally wiped. Wiped. As far as I was concerned, the whole thing had collapsed. The opportunity was lost. The problem for me was that we had gone beyond the Rubicon. We were now into a protracted hunger strike, which was going to be impossible, virtually impossible to get away from unless you put the hands up.
I was in the cell myself with Brendan Hughes, and I remember discussing the whole thing with him. We argued the point with others, is it necessary to go on, have we haven't made the point, and what's going on here, why is this here being prolonged, and these issues be debated, what has to be gained now? But nothing more will be gained from one other death. And the whole thing became very, very politicised with the elections. We had Paddy Agnew, Ciarán Doherty being elected, be a big, massive thing. It was so changing the very, very nature, and became more electoral. It became more of an electoral strategy than it did a sort of strategy of the haste blocks. We'd move from that there into something else, and it seemed to be being manipulated by people who started to see the gains that could be made.
By July, 5 hunger strikers were dead, but 2 of their fellow prisoners had been elected as TDs in the Dáil. Sinn Féin's election gamble was reaping rewards, and as its campaign on the streets gained momentum, tension continued to rise.
But there was an overflow effect down here. We had 5,000 people marching at the British Embassy, mainly from Northern Ireland, IRA people, to attack the Gardaí, which they did. If they had broken through, the army was the next line of defence, and a confrontation between an army and demonstrators is never thing you want to happen.
Clearly these were organised riots. They were not spontaneous gestures of sympathy. People were brought out by the Republican movement, were organised by the Republican movement, and given what they were up to elsewhere at that time, one could never be sure how far they would go and how far they would attempt to go. We had the burning down of a British embassy. We had the murder of a British ambassador. And here we were seeking to maintain some sort of balance in the relationship between Dublin and London, now faced with pretty ugly scenes. happily, you know, the worst did not happen. But nevertheless, there were some scary moments in the summer of 1981.
With still no sign of a deal, and with street fighting in the south, and IRA and British Army shootings in the north, the crisis was deepening. It seemed just a matter of time until the next man died on hunger strike.
Shortly after Joe McDonald had died, Martin Herzen was the next prisoner who was into the 40-odd day mark. And it was actually a shock, and it shocked everybody that Martin had died, because nobody expected that. We weren't near a crisis period. And on the following Sunday at Mass, Father Fall confronted me, and I remember him, this blistering row with him over Martin Herzen.
Father Fall came in, and he knew Martin Herzen very well, because Martin was from Tyrone, and Father Fall had a parisher, he was a teacher there, and he was just incandescent with rage. And he came over to Beck and he just pointed at him and he says, "You, McFarlane, you killed Martin Herzen." And Beck went nuts.
It was explosive, and it really was hard, and it was a bad situation.
I said, "You're putting men on who are not fit."
I think Maggie Thatcher is the one that we need to talk about here, who have us in this situation.
Beck was jumping with rage, and I had to get in between him and Fall and calm it down, and the both of them were shouting over each other.
I began to wonder, I said, what is the object of this strike?
It was explosive.
To get great publicity and recruitment for the IRA. Is it the funerals you want? Is it the funerals you want?
Martin Herzen became the sixth hunger striker to be buried in 10 weeks, and the heavy toll was beginning to have an impact on the Republican movement.
I mean, we used to speak about the conveyor belt prison. We were now on a treadmill to death. We were on a never-ending funeral.
It almost felt as if we were caught in a vicious circle that we couldn't escape from.
After a while, it became a tragedy that looked like it was unstoppable. But certainly from the outside, it looked to me like the concept of pride was infinitely more important than the concept of life.
The more people died, the more and more we'd become entrenched. The more and more it was impossible for the British government to concede.
They didn't want concessions, they wanted power. They wanted power over the prison regime to do what the hell they liked in prison.
As each hunger striker died, everybody started to question what was the point of another death. And, you know, it became crystal clear to everybody that Maggie Thatcher was going to let as many men die as possible. And we didn't want this here. Other lives were on the line. We didn't see any way out of it. We didn't see any way that it could end, apart from the British actually giving in to the five demands. And we didn't consider that at all.
But plans to break the deadlock were already beginning to take shape. Not in Dublin, London, or the Maze Prison, but in a small hotel in Tombridge, 30 miles northwest of Belfast.
I was at a meeting where a number of women discussed taking over the pulpits in churches. Father Fall was also at the meeting. I personally believe that that was the point at which the church began to say, just as the British had said in the mid-70s, we can't ride this tiger. It is eating into us. We have got to stamp it out. And it was that point where the church changed its ambiguity on the prisoners to concentrating on getting the prisoners off the strike.
I knew once you interfere with negotiations, you'd be totally rejected by Sinn Féin. They want to do all the negotiating themselves. So once I called that meeting of mothers, I knew I was finished in regard to the affections of Sinn Féin.
Father Fall was in very close association with the families. He was, of course, concerned about the preservation of human life, both inside and outside the prisons.
He began to understand the suffering of the less than willing hunger strikers and of their families. And I think he did a remarkable job.
Father Fall had discovered that when their sons were close to death and became unconscious, the families had the legal right to intervene and save their lives. And he called the meeting in Tonbridge to encourage them to do just that.
The main purpose of that meeting was to break the families, to get some of the families of the men on hunger strike to undertake that at the moment at which the men became declared by somebody in the prison authority as unfit to make a decision, that the family would make the decision and take them off the hunger strike. That was a very painful meeting because none of the families wanted to take that decision.
But one woman at the meeting was prepared to intervene on behalf of her son, the mother of IRA man Paddy Quinn.
I had my mind made up, I sort of think then. He says, I want him off the hunger strike. Eugene says, are you sure about this? He says, should you not see the rest of the family, John or Lawrence or somebody? So I says, no. There's no time for that.
On the 31st of July, Paddy Quinn became the first prisoner to come off the hunger strike. Others soon followed as their families intervened to save their lives. Now the end was in sight.
The situation was quickly becoming untenable in the sense that the majority of guys who were in the hospital on hunger strike had been told by their families that regardless of what their wishes were, regardless of their loyalty to their comrades, regardless of how the actual prisoner felt about it, that once they reached the critical stage, they were going to intervene. We signed up to something. The prisoners signed up to something. Our families never signed on for anything.
Following the intervention of the prisoners' families, by August, the protest was drawing to a bitter end. But before it could finally do so, four more hunger strikers, Kevin Lynch, Kieran Doherty, Thomas McElwee, and Michael Devine, were to die on hunger strike inside the Maze prison.
Republican prisoners on hunger strike in the Maze prison near Belfast have announced that they're ending their protest. A statement sent out of the...
Now, let me make it absolutely clear as I say a word about the hunger strike. No concessions have been made to the IRA, and there will be certainly no perpetration of anything which looks like concessions to those who commit violence.
Within 2 years of the hunger strike, the British government met most of the prisoners' demands. But as a result of their protest, these 10 men, photographed by prison officers on the day they started to refuse food, died without the political status they sought. For some Republicans, the death toll was unnecessarily high. And 25 years on, debate continues to rage over precisely what happened on the first weekend of July 1981. The weekend when the offer of a deal was made by the British government, when Danny Morrison travelled to the Maze prison to speak to Big McFarlane, and Joe McDonald was about to become the fifth hunger striker to die.
Sunday morning, Pick was brought up to the camp hospital where he met Danny Morrison. He came back to the wing and went back into his cell and sent me up a comm. telling me that there was a person codenamed the Mountain Claimer, and that he had made certain proposals, right, aimed at ending the hunger strike. The proposals being we'd have our own clothes, we'd have segregation, work would be orientated towards education. The one sticking point was free association. The Brits were not going to give us free association. Then I got back up and I says, "Beck, tag a lower on, there's enough there." And his response was, "Ain't them lad, I agree with you. Scrivey may hunt even we, as curry may fiss or who. I'll write the outside and I'll let them know." And that was the way it was.
The fact that there was an offer from the British government has never been in question. What is in question is who rejected it. The prisoners in the maze, or the Republican leadership on the outside.
The calm wasn't a hard and fast order in that sense, do not accept this offer. It was, we are surprised to see that you have accepted this offer. Which meant that we don't accept it, or we do not think you should accept it. And that was the lane. Here's the lane, guys. This isn't good enough.
Firstly, a conversation in Irish out of cell window in H Block 3 with 40 other prisoners in the wing, the most of them, some of them with far better Irish than I have, would not have allowed secrecy, for starters. Somebody, with my cellmate would have heard, his cellmates, the adjoining cells, the ones across the way, the ones behind, everybody would have heard the conversation. And there's nowhere in the history of that, of anybody, either at the time, in the direct aftermath, or in the aftermath of his book coming out, has even uttered a whisper in relation to that conversation having taken place.
What I can't confirm is that the allegations made by O'Raw that he advised Brent McFarren to accept the deal, and that Brent McFarren's response was that he thought there was enough there. I have had that confirmed by a prisoner on the wing. Independent verification that O'Raw's account is correct.
Then he says that that I had received a communication in from the army leadership directing me not, or directing us as hunger strikers as well, not to accept any deal. That's preposterous.
If there was this sensational offer that the Republican leadership on the outside had maliciously or otherwise influenced the hunger strikers against, and this was such a revelation, one would have thought that in the past 25 years, someone from the Northern Ireland office would have used that against Sinn Féin, against Gerry Adams. Indeed, it was never heard of until last year.
Whatever the truth of what happened that weekend in July 1981, the hunger strike was to become a defining episode in the history of the Troubles. An episode that lasted 217 days, during which 10 men died inside the maze prison, and 68 people were killed through violence on the outside. And an episode that divides opinions and communities to this day.
I have serious reservations about the revision and rewriting and repackaging of all of it as part of the glorious struggle, because those of us who lived through it would counsel against ever doing it again.
The people I admire is the parents, Mrs. Lynch, Mrs. Quinn. They're the ones I admire, those people. I wonder what they think now. Do they think it was a waste of life? I'd say there is an increasing opinion that it was a waste of life.
For Republicans, and I'm still an activist, I think, for Republicans, they've set a huge example to us, you know, in terms of self-sacrifice, generosity.
Isn't it tragic that Sinn Féin's rise comes from 10 men dead? But undoubtedly it did.
I do believe that when you look at your television now and see Gerry Adams wandering around Washington, it's useful to remind yourself that it was the hunger strike that did this. As Bobby Sands organised those parties in the White House on St. Patrick's Day, which every Republican leaders can literally rub shoulders with the great and the good of the Western world, boy, do they owe Bobby Sands big time.
Thank you.